In this video, we see two kinds of flip-flops and how they work. We see the level-sensitive and the edge-triggered flip-flops. We see also how we can build a clock divider with an edge-triggered flip-flop. The SR latch is one of the fundamental parts of flip-flops. This is called set and reset latch because you can put a 1 on the output and reset it, acting on the two inputs. It can be built with NAND or NOR gates. Let's see the working. First, we remember the truth table of the NAND gate, which is this. The output is 0 only when both the inputs are 1s. Then we see the bar upon set and reset inputs. That's because usually we keep the input in the high state and we give some 0 pulses to change the state of the circuit. Let's see the truth table of the NAND SR latch. The inputs are set and reset, and the output is Q. We leave out not Q because it's always the opposite of Q. If we give a 0 pulse to set, keeping a reset to 1, we get 1 on the output. If we give a 0 pulse to reset, keeping set to 1, we get 0 on the output. If we now come back with both the input to 1, we can have 1 or 0 on the output depending on the previous situation. In this case, our last pulse was the reset, so we have a 0 on the output. This is how latch remembers a bit. Acting on set and reset, we put a 1 or a 0 to the output Q, and we can store it by keeping set and reset to 1. Our default situation is with set and reset both to 1, and we act by giving some 0 pulses to change the output value. So in the default configuration, the flip-flop stores a bit, and if we want to change the bit stored, we have to give a 0 pulse to set or to reset. The last input combination is 0-0. In this case, we should have a 1 in both Q and Q bar. But this is true when the 0 pulses arrive perfectly synchronized to the inputs and when they propagate perfectly synchronized, so not in the real cases. Let's see what happens when both the inputs are 0 but the pulses are out of phase. In this first case, the set 0 pulse arrives after the reset 1, so in this case you can see a train of little pulses arriving in the inputs and consequently changing the output. But let's go in order. This is our timeline, and we'll see very slowly what happens. We start with 2-1 on the inputs, and the output keeps its previous value. After a while, a 0 reset pulse comes, but not yet the set pulse, so we have just a 0 reset pulse situation, and Q is 0. After another while, we have 0 to both the inputs, and Q is 1, but after another moment we have a 0 pulse on set and Q turns to 1. At the end, the inputs return to 1, thus remembering the last situation. You can see the last situation is a 0 pulse in set, so Q remains 1 and Q bar remains 0. If set had arrived before the reset, Q would have been 0 and Q bar 1. For this reason, in the 0-0 situation, we cannot control the output, so it is not used, being considered invalid. Now we complicate a bit the circuit. We add the clock, and this is the SR flip-flop. The clock, of course, is a signal going up and down with a certain frequency, but when the clock is 0, set and reset can have any values. But surely we have 2 1s on the input of the SR latch, so it is in the memory situation, keeping Q and Q bar in the previous state. When the clock is 1, if set is 1 and reset is 0, we have this situation, and if set is 0 and reset is 1, we have this other situation. So when clock is 1, Q takes the value of set and Q bar the value of reset. If both set and reset are to 0, it's easy to see that we are again in the memory situation of the latch, keeping Q at the previous value. And last, if the inputs are both to 1, we have zeros in the input of the SR latch, and we are in the invalid situation. So we have a circuit which keeps the memory when the clock is low, and it can be changed when the clock is high. But unfortunately, we have again the invalid situation still possible. Let's see how to improve the circuit and pass to the D flip-flop. in the end, we are interested in this part of the circuit, so we can add an inverter between the two inputs and have a D flip-flop. In this way, the two inputs cannot have the same values, and we have a circuit called level-sensitive D flip-flop. Because when the clock is high, you can change the state of Q and Q bar, and this is true for all the time in which the clock is high. Let's see the circuit in Circuitverse Simulator. Here we see the situation in which the clock is high and the input is at 1, passing through till Q. Same behavior when the D input is at 0 and the clock is kept at 1. But let's see the timing simulation. Here you see the clock on the top and below the D input and the Q output. You see, when the clock is high, the D input at 1 passes to Q, and when D input goes to 0, Q goes to 0 because the clock is still high. Here, the input turns back to 1, but Q input doesn't follow because now the clock is 0 and Q is kept to the previous value. So, you see, when the clock is high, the input passes through. And when clock is 0, Q is kept on the last value. Here, for example, you see that if D input goes to 1 and come back to 0 on the 0 clock period, Q output loses completely this transition. This circuit is called level-sensitive D flip-flop because the output can be changed only on the high level of the clock signal. Now, we modify our circuit in such a way we read the input D only on the rising edge of the clock. For this reason, NAND 1 and 2 have three inputs, one for the data D or D bar, another for the clock, and the third for the clock bar or not clock. But in the path of the clock bar, we put three NOT gates instead of one, in order to introduce a delay. In such a way, when the clock is rising high, the clock bar remains high a little longer before switching to zero. So, in that moment, two of the three inputs of the NAND 1 and 2 are at 1, and the D input can pass through till Q. So, in this circuit, the data D is read only on the rising edge of the clock. Otherwise, Q output is kept to the previous value. Here, a timing simulation where you can see the clock bar or not clock, the D input and the Q output. You can see on the rising edge of the clock bar is still high for a little longer, and Q takes the value of D. So, the input D is read only on the rising edge of the clock, and for the rest of the time, Q remains in the previous state. So now, we put in a box our rising edge D flip-flop and connect the NOT Q output with the D input. Here is the time simulation, where we see the clock, the input and Q output. We see that on the rising edge of the clock, Q takes the input D, which is 0. But immediately afterwards, NOT Q turns the input in 1, but Q doesn't change, keeping 0 till the next rising edge, where D is still at 1, so Q turns to 1. You can see Q switches between 0 and 1 at half the frequency of the clock, so we ended up cutting the clock frequency in half. If we want to divide the clock by 4, we connect two D flip-flops in this way. The time simulation is this, and as you can see, the Q period of oscillation lasts 4 clock cycles. In this way, we can divide by any multiple of 2. Please leave me a comment, let me know if you liked this video. Make sure you put a thumb up, click the notification bell, and subscribe to my channel.